The Masai Mara, one of Africa's most iconic landscapes. A vast sea of grass within Kenya's Great Rift Valley. And home to one of the greatest wildlife spectacles on Earth. The Great Migrations. The rich grasslands attract vast herds of grazers. And they also attract some of Africa's largest predators. The lion, the strongest and most powerful of all. And the cheetah, the fastest and most agile hunter on the savannah. But the most successful hunter of them all is too often overlooked, the hyena. Hyenas have a reputation as cowardly thieves and scavengers, but in fact, they are highly intelligent and efficient predators. Working together as a pack, they can bring down animals many times their size. In a team, they are arguably the most successful predator of all. Dry season in the Masai Mara. It's a difficult time for the hyenas. Prey is scarce on the ground, and their young cubs need food. There has been no rain for over 3 months, and only the hardiest will survive. Hyenas usually hunt in packs, and if they do not find food, the whole clan goes hungry. This time, they're lucky. They've found the carcass of a hippo, ample food for the entire pack. Their powerful teeth and jaws can tear the toughest skin and crush bones to get to the nutritious marrow. They will consume every part of the carcass. A lion has brought down a wild boar. It's a meager meal, but the large herds of zebra and wildebeest will not arrive until after the rains. The fresh kill is eyed enviously by others. A hyena takes the opportunity to make off with a piece of the bounty. In fact, more often, it's lions who steal prey from hyenas. But this time, the big cats have to watch their backs. The lions have had their fill, and now the hyena pack can finish off the rest. There's a change in the air. rain clouds gather above the Masai Mara. The parched land and its inhabitants have been waiting for this moment. Overnight, the life-giving waters will transform the African savannah. Biologist Kay Hollycamp from Michigan State University has been studying spotted hyenas in the Masai Mara for over 20 years. Today, she's on a mission to sedate one of them with a tranquilizer dart in order to measure and examine it.
If Tracy is actually able to get a shot, do not move. Do not turn your camera. Do not make a sound. Do not do anything. Just everybody has to freeze, okay? So get the camera where you want it to be, because if she hits it, then we can't scare it.
Kay's student Tracy has been helping her for nearly a year now and is proficient with the tranquilizer gun. Nevertheless, she is nervous. It's crucial the animals don't realize the dart was shot from the scientist's car. If they do, they'll no longer trust the approach of the vehicle, and the entire project will be in danger. It usually takes around 10 minutes for the tranquilizer to take effect. But hyenas are tough, and this animal will not go down easily. After 20 minutes, the young female finally collapses on the ground. Tracy places a cloth over the hyena's eyes to shield it from the sun. And Kay takes a blood sample for testing in the lab. They measure the animal's teeth to check its general health and growth. Then Kay carefully removes the dart.
16.5.
Hyenas scent mark their territories with an oily secretion from their anal gland. A sample is taken for further analysis.
Heavy.
And finally, the young female is weighed. Kay and her team load the sedated hyena onto the jeep to take her to a safe spot. She wouldn't survive for long out here in the open. Temperatures on the plains rise to over 40 degrees in the midday sun, and the sedated animal would be an easy target for other hungry predators. Kay knows the Masai Mara like the back of her hand and has found a shady place to release the young hyena. They place her under the bushes and cool her down with water. Then the hiding place is camouflaged with twigs and branches. The young hyena is starting to wake up. She will not remember anything of what has happened. Or so the biologists hope. Kay Hollycamp spends 2 to 3 months every year in the Masai Mara. She has tagged a few hyenas from one particular group with radio transmitters and has called them the Talek clan after a nearby river. Each morning, she and her team set off at dawn to track down and follow the family. The researchers have given every animal a name.
We might have to check the other side.
There is a Reagan and an Obama, and each one has its own unique pattern of spots, like a fingerprint.
So she has this really nice horizontal line across her side, and then kind of a wishbone shape there. We've got the adult female still walking to the south, southeast maybe. About 20 meters away is Jeeves, and about 60 meters away is Puma, all walking in the same direction.
Yeah, sometimes the youngsters use the adults.
The main focus of Kay's research is to unravel the complex social system of spotted hyenas. The scientists follow the animals for up to 5 hours each day and record every movement and interaction. Back in camp, all the data is put onto the computer and painstakingly analysed. The camp is on the northern edge of the Masai Mara National Park, deep inside the African bush. It's an unlikely place for modern-day techniques, but in their makeshift lab, the team somehow managed to analyse the samples they collect. With patience and dedication, the team have gathered vast amounts of data and gained a unique insight into the lives of spotted hyenas. Their research has revealed that the animal's reputation as a mean and dim-witted scavenger is far from the truth. Behind the seemingly ugly exterior lies a highly intelligent and complex creature.
I think it's become clear that hyenas are much more interesting and complex animals than anyone had previously assumed. They had a very bad reputation up until, the 1990s, I think, in terms of being skulking carrion eaters that would steal food from the real hunters, quote-unquote, like cheetahs and lions and leopards. But in fact, we now know these animals are extraordinarily good hunters. They kill animals that are 3 or 4 times their own body mass on their own. We know that they live in a primate-like society, and they recognize one another, and they remember their social interactions, and they can solve social problems that, as far as we know, only primates have been shown to be able to solve in the past.
Spotted hyenas live in large clans of up to 80 individuals. It's a matriarchal society, with females outranking the males. Hyena mothers suckle their cubs for nearly 18 months. It's an unusually long time, but probably a necessity, as most kills are made far from the den. Not until they're 4 years old can the young hyenas hunt for themselves. The Masai Mara is remarkable for its great concentration of large grazers. Over 2 million buffalo, zebra, wildebeest, and antelope feed on the endless seas of grass. It's a rich supply of food for predators, and hyenas thrive here. They will tackle almost any kind of prey, one of the reasons for their success. Zebras have a fiery temperament and sharp hooves, and it can take a team of 10 to 20 hyenas to bring one down.
The way hyenas hunt is actually very different from any of the other animals here in terms of how they hunt. The hyenas actually will be wandering across the plain, come across a group of potential prey, rush it, and then send them into a flurry of flight and confusion, and then the hyena somehow can actually pick out a vulnerable individual. Those tend to be either animals that are quite elderly, that have some sort of physical problem like a limp, or sometimes very pregnant females who are carrying a heavy fetus and have a hard time running quickly.
The topi, a large savannah antelope, is a favorite prey of spotted hyenas. It's breeding season, and the males have gathered to fight for mating rights. The strongest will have their pick of the females. The losers will go without. It's hard work during the midday heat, and the animals take a rest from their exertions. But down on the ground, they may not see approaching danger. The hyenas are taking a cooling mud bath. It's pleasant in the sweltering heat, and it rids the fur of parasites. It may also help to cool down before embarking on a hunt. Hyenas usually hunt under cover of darkness, but this female, just emerged from her bath, has other plans. Kay has noticed that some animals will hunt topi during the day, particularly in the rainy season, when the antelopes congregate to mate. The hyena strolls by with a casual, careless gait, apparently showing no interest in the topi, until the last minute. No luck this time. Close shave for the topi. It has escaped with just a small wound. On their own, hyenas have a much smaller chance of making a kill. Only 1 in 5 of all attempts is successful. Yet when it comes to hunting topi, Kay Hollicamp believes that alone they may stand a better chance.
My observation of it suggests that it's usually an individual affair, and this is one of those times where they prefer not to hunt in groups. They're usually tiptoeing very quietly among the dozing topis individually, and that's a case where if they can actually take a topi by surprise, they may be able to just grab it.
Lake Nakuru, one of the Rift Valley's many soda lakes, 150 kilometers northeast of the Masai Mara. It attracts millions of flamingos that feed on the abundance of algae in its waters. The lake lies within a national park and is a haven for water birds. Hyenas also live on the shores of the lake. The females with cubs spend most of the day playing and lounging on the sandy beach. But these hyenas have a rather unusual diet. They hunt flamingos on the lake. It's a remarkable scene, and even Kay has never seen hyenas go for this kind of prey before.
Love that swimming. We don't get to see them swim here often enough.
The biologists are excited to witness a hunt in the water.
I love that avoid.
No, that's really cute.
But Kay's not overly surprised. It's just more evidence of the hyena's adaptability.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised at all if you had hyenas that lived around these Rift Valley lakes that were actually flamingo specialists, and because it's such an abundant food source when the flamingos are present. So I think it would be totally expected for them to actually be specializing on flamingos. They're clearly pretty good at it. She got that one with no trouble at all.
Back in the Masai Mara, it's a greater struggle for survival. Here, the hyenas have to face competition from other big predators. The cheetah is the fastest hunter on the open plains, reaching speeds of over 100 kilometers an hour. This athletic cat can outrun any predator or prey. These three cheetah brothers hunt as a team, and they share their spoils. They are unaware that they're being watched. The hyena has robbed the cheetahs of their bounty. But that's not all. The rest of the clan have arrived, and they look like they mean business. The pack have driven one of the brothers up a tree. Cheetahs are not good climbers, but the young male has little choice. He is no match for the powerful and aggressive hyenas. His brothers can do little but watch anxiously from a safe distance. It's not until nightfall that the hyenas finally move on. Another hippo has fallen victim to two male lions. 1.5 tons of fresh meat out on the grassland are a major attraction for other predators and scavengers. The lions can't consume a carcass this size in one sitting, so they will feed on it for the next few days. For now, the hyenas keep a respectful distance, as do other interested parties, a jackal and a flock of vultures. Challenging two adult lions could prove to be fatal. The hyenas wait for the lions to withdraw for an afternoon nap. Then they take their chance. But this will be a short-lived feast. They were lucky. The lion's pursuit was half-hearted. With a full belly, defending his prize is quite an effort. Now the vultures seize the opportunity too. Like vultures, hyenas can eat and digest almost anything, meat, bones, and offal. They are both hunter and scavenger, taking whatever is on offer. The lion decides to defend his kill after all. And the lion is not giving up so easily. A close encounter for the hyena. Lions do not usually tolerate such competition and frequently kill their rivals. Over half of all hyena deaths are from interactions with lions, usually at kills such as this.
The relationships between hyenas and lions generally not very good. It's uneasy at best and downright murderous at worst. For the most part, these animals are relying on exactly the same resource base. Hyenas and lions feed on the same size and same diversity of antelope, and yet the lions are, well, a lioness is four times the size of an adult hyena, and a single adult male lion can actually kill a hyena with just a swat of its paw.
Every evening, the research team check on the hyena den by the Talek River. The communal den houses all the youngsters from the clan, of varying ages and from different mothers.
So at 1808, we arrive at Riverbend Den. We have one cub sacked out and one cub stand look about 15 meters from the den, and one, two, three, four cubs stand or wander sniff about 8 meters from the den.
The den is the center of clan activity. It's here where friendships and alliances are forged. The younger cubs are still safely below ground, but the older ones are already busy exploring their surroundings.
So the communal den hole is just right ahead of the vehicle there. You can see three cubs sacked out in front of the den hole. And this is actually a big aardvark den complex that the hyenas have modified a bit, and they're using this den hole as well as a couple of others off to the sides, and the cubs move among them fairly freely because they're old enough to do that without danger. They're pretty well able to run out of trouble if they get into it. And at this particular den right now, we have 15 cubs ranging in age from about 2 months to almost 9 months, actually.
The young hyenas are looked after not just by their mothers, but also by older siblings, aunts, and other females in the clan. Teamwork and cooperation are key to the hyena's success. These hunters have got their eye on the kill of a female lion. It's a risky operation, and their only chance is to work as a team. The pack attack with lightning speed. The lioness knows she is outnumbered. It takes at least four hyenas to drive a lioness from her kill. Against an adult male, they would stand little chance. As night falls on the Talek River, the scientists get ready for the late shift. Hyenas are mainly nocturnal, and as more and more animals emerge, the activity around the den increases. With the help of spotlights, the team observe and record the interactions between clan members.
Endor, who is the subordinate twin to Alderaan, is also wandering 15 meters from the den.
Hyena societies are complex, and it's all about who you know and who is your ally. It's a lesson the young cubs have to learn quickly.
This is Jeeves.
The clan are used to the research vehicle and take little notice of its inhabitants. Indeed, something else seems to have attracted their attention. The recent rains have triggered the emergence of termites. It's a natural midnight snack for the hyenas, but the young cubs seem slightly disconcerted.
Yeah, it's great watching them eat the termites.
It's not easy the first time you try it, and it takes some practice catching the flying prey. Spotted hyenas are born apparently ready for action, with a sharp set of teeth and wide open eyes. Nonetheless, these youngsters are nowhere near ready to hunt and will catch little more than a mouthful of termites in the coming year. Hyena mothers care for their cubs for up to 4 years, much longer than most predators. Why is this so? Maybe a complex social system requires a longer period of learning. Or maybe their bone-crushing jaws take several years to mature. One thing is certain. Not until they're 3 to 4 years old can young hyenas hunt and crack open bones. Kay believes that this could be the reason for their matriarchal society. Maybe females evolved to be dominant and more aggressive to protect and feed their cubs.
So we're leaving at 7:48.
The team decide to head back to camp.
No final scan due to
in just a few hours, they'll be setting off once more to rejoin the hyenas at dawn. In the early hours of the morning, mothers and cubs share intimate moments. And the indigestible remains of the evening meal are disposed of as small pellets. The pellets have a pungent smell, and mother and son roll in it to take on the scent. It seems to impress the other members of the clan. And social rank in the clan affects every aspect of hyena life. Cubs fight from birth for their place in the hierarchy. The status quo is regularly challenged. Pecking orders constantly change. Whatever may have caused this argument, it's all about power and status, and shifting alliances. It's a noisy affair. A complex social arrangement requires a complex language, and the huge variety of whoops, grunts, and giggles communicates their intentions. The power struggle is over. Having re-established their positions, the rivals bury the hatchet. At the end of the day, their survival depends on teamwork. Kay has learnt the method behind the bickering.
Yeah, I think if you actually look closely at the decisions that individual hyenas make about, for example, whether or not to help another animal when it needs help, that tells you what complicated decision-making processes are taking place in their heads. They're actually taking into consideration who the potential recipient of their help is. They're taking into consideration the other hyenas that are immediately present in their social environment for fear perhaps if they help this guy, then that guy will retaliate and bite me. They're taking into consideration the local ecological situation. They behave very differently when there's a lot of food versus when there's not. They're actually taking into consideration a phenomenal number of variables. It's really surprising.
Hyena cubs have much to learn aside from social and political etiquette. This youngster is making his first encounter with potential prey, but it may still be slightly out of his league. His mother looks on anxiously. The tusks of a wild boar can inflict fatal injuries even on a fully grown lion. The youngster will do better to watch the adults and see how it's done. An adult female is eyeing up the situation. She's heading towards a herd of topi. Most of the large grazers have seen the predator approach and are keeping a watchful eye. Her short sprints cause them little concern. They can easily outrun her with their long legs. But now the hyena has detected an inattentive animal in the grass. This is her chance. A last-minute escape for the topi. It can run at speeds of 70 kilometers per hour, and the hyena finally gives up the futile chase. But with a piece of skin ripped from its flanks, the antelope is lucky to have got away with its life. Life in the African savannah has been ruled for millennia by the cycles of rain and drought, of predators and prey. Today, the Masai Mara is a national park, a protected island of grassland within a landscape of fields and villages. But neither the wildlife nor the Maasai nomads and their cattle have enough space here. Not surprisingly, the Maasai take their livestock into the protected areas because there's still enough grass here. It's a recipe for disaster. In the early hours of dawn, the Talek clan attack a herd of cattle. Kay Hollycamp is following the hyenas and witnesses the event. The clan try to separate a single animal from the herd. The Maasai herders arrive just in time to scare off the predators. But not all encounters end this way. If the hyenas had killed one of their cattle, the Maasai would have sought revenge.
There has been an enormous change with respect to livestock in the park. When we first started working here in the late 1980s, there was the occasional herd of 20 or 30 cows tucked very carefully and secretively down in the riverbed. And now there are tens of thousands of cows and tens of thousands of goats and sheep as well every single day out here on the plain. It's really tremendously disturbing to see it.
The agricultural fields push right up to the park boundaries. And since the reserve was created in the 1960s, Kenya's population has grown from 8 to over 40 million people. There are now suggestions to let the Maasai enter the park for periods of time. But whether this will help is not clear.
I think we've started a very very bad cycle in which the local pastoralists bring their livestock into the park. That drives the wild antelope away. The hyenas are left with very little food other than the livestock to prey upon. And this is true not only for the hyenas, but also for the other large carnivores in the area. They either have to move, which is very difficult because they all defend territories and they can't just go where they want to, or they actually have to find something else to eat. And if the only thing to eat is livestock, that's going to cause more and more trouble, I'm afraid. The hyenas will ultimately lose this battle. We can be sure of that.
National parks such as the Maasai Mara are more than a nature reserve and tourist attraction. They are the last stronghold of Africa's true wilderness. If these final frontiers should fall, then Africa's large predators, including the hyena, have little chance of survival. The Talek clan are attempting another attack on the herd of topi. The persistent hunters are not easily discouraged and appear to have all the time in the world. They know they will eventually strike lucky when one of the antelope dozes off for a second too long. Nearly, but not quite. This time, the hunter approaches from behind, in the animal's blind spot. Whilst trying to break free, the unfortunate topi has broken one of its hind legs. Its fate is now sealed. The topi is down, and reinforcement is on its way. The battle is over, but now a different struggle begins. Dominant clan members get first choice at the kill, starting with the alpha female. But in the initial excitement, the buffet turns into a scrum as everyone tries to get a piece of the meal. The mothers now need to assert their position at the kill and ensure their older cubs get a share. Hyenas don't carry food back to the den, and the growing youngsters need more than just their mother's milk. News of the feast spreads quickly, and clan members now appear from every direction. The lowest-ranking members of the clan, especially the males, wait anxiously on the sidelines, hoping eventually to get a turn at the dinner table. In less than an hour, the topi has been entirely dismantled, down to the last bone. It's hard to imagine a more efficient form of food processing. It's the uniqueness of hyena societies that so intrigues scientists like Kay Hollicamp.
To me, they pose a very interesting biological puzzle. They actually appear to violate a lot of the basic rules of mammalian biology, and I'm putting rules there in quotes because the fact that the hyenas appear to violate those rules suggests that those really aren't the rules at all. So, what we thought historically makes a male mammal, and a female, the hyenas appear to violate. The females are very heavily masculinized in some ways, but not others. What appears to be a typical mammalian carnivore or social system is completely violated in the hyenas because they live in societies like baboon societies, not like lion societies or canid societies or mongoose societies. So they violate these rules in a lot of ways that makes them a really fascinating puzzle.
But how intelligent are hyenas? Case experiments are revealing that the much maligned scavengers are in fact rather clever, maybe as clever as primates. Marked with a radio collar, Gucci is a particularly intelligent female. This experiment is designed to test the problem-solving skills and the memory of hyenas. Kay places a steel cage in the grass. Then she puts a piece of meat inside, and the latch is bolted securely. The hyenas will smell the meat, but won't be able to reach it. The solid latch can't be opened accidentally. The animal has to know how it works. Then Kay drives the jeep to a safe distance to observe what happens.
Gucci begins her approach of the puzzle box at 8:10.
Within a few minutes, Gucci approaches the cage. She learned to solve this problem a few years ago. Kay is intrigued to see whether she remembers. Many scientists believe that humans and primates, and maybe also hyenas, are more intelligent because they live in large social groups. Dealing with the challenges of a complex society requires social intelligence and the ability to learn. Gucci clearly knows there is a way into the cage, and that the latch is the key to the solution.
Come on, Gooch.
She's got the bolt slitted. She's got to get the door right now.
Gucci has not only solved the problem, she's done it considerably quicker than the first time. It's an extraordinary achievement. A lion or cheetah would never have succeeded, but not all hyenas have managed either. So are they really as clever and resourceful as primates, or are they just exceptional individuals? That's a question scientists have been trying to answer for years. Kay is convinced the hyenas have more surprises in store for her and her team. And she has achieved much already. Thanks to Kay and others, the hyena's reputation as a primitive scavenger has been overturned. We now know them to be surprisingly social animals and tender parents. There may be faster, bigger, and more powerful predators in the savannah. But as a team, hyenas are one of Africa's most successful hunters. The hyena is truly the queen of the Masai Mara.